Welcome to the Inner West Library Speaker Series. We would like to start by acknowledging the Gadigal and the Wangal people of the Eora Nation on which this podcast is produced. Today, we are joined by Lisa Forrest to discuss her latest book, Glide, Taking the Panic Out of Modern Living. Lisa is an Olympian, TV and radio broadcaster and author, as well as a motivational speaker, mental skills coach and teacher of mindfulness-based stress reduction. She became a household name as a teenager when she burst onto the international swimming scene, representing her country and captaining the Australian women's swimming team at the 1980 Olympic Games in Moscow. Glide is the story of what happened when Lisa took time out to answer a question that had been weighing her down for years. Why, no matter what she achieved, was she never enough for herself? Welcome, Lisa.
Thank you, Judy. Hi.
You've had an extremely varied career, which has included some amazing achievements, and one of those is becoming an author. You've written several books, including works of fiction, non-fiction, children's books, and even a young adult fantasy novel. This is obviously quite a different genre compared to your current book, Glide. How did you come to writing, and what inspired you to write Glide?
Well, I came to writing because I was a reader, and when I was a little girl or a young person, I seemed to read about a lot of girls who kept diaries, and so I did as well. And then when I started swimming for Australia, I was 14 on my first international trip, and I was away for 10 weeks, or going to be away for 10 weeks. That was back in 1978, and, you know, instant communication wasn't available, and international phone calls were incredibly expensive. So for my family, a working class family, they had the budget for me to call home once a week. And so I was just so incredibly homesick that as soon as I sort of got there, I started writing long letters and then many, you know, successive aerograms. And if people sent me one card with a few lines, they'd get a huge letter back. You know, it just helped with my homesickness. And so, yeah, eventually I became a journalist, of course, and then wrote my first book in 2000, Making the Most of It was published then. So it was a gradual progression. I think I thought that I had to be somebody that was really imaginative to be a writer. So there was a long time where I just didn't think that I could write novels. And so in many ways, that's what Inheritance was about, which is that the young adult fantasy novel. And it was the book previous to Glide. And my doubt and my thinking took me down into very black holes with that. And back in when I was swimming for Australia, when I was 18, I went to my second Commonwealth Games and I won gold medals. But I told the journalist then that I nearly didn't make it because I had what I called trouble with my thinking. You know, there were no psychologists around then. Nobody was diagnosing anxiety or anything like that. But I knew it was my thinking and I knew my thinking got me in trouble. The movie Rocky Three had come out just before those Commonwealth Games, and it changed my thinking. And then when I wrote my Inheritance, I was 48, and so the thinking had not got any better. So I just thought, okay, I've got to stop and work it out. So I started with a life coaching course, and then that led me to mindfulness-based stress reduction. And suddenly when I just, you know, the first guided meditation I ever went on was that you could actually let a thought go just by coming back to the feeling of the breath. That was complete liberation for me. And, you know, a few other things happened, and I just thought, wow, if only we all practice mindfulness, we could save ourselves a lot of stress. I'll write a book about it and maybe convince people that this might be the way to go. And so that's how Glide came about.
Fantastic. In Glide, you talk about two distinct swimming periods in your life and their different leadership styles. There was the compassionate leadership of the DY Ladies Swimming Club and their can-do kindness, and then the tough love of fear and shame-based leadership during your Olympic training. Can you tell us a bit more about these two obviously very different styles of leadership and how they affected your mental state at the time?
Sure, yeah, and I think that was the revelation for me that also kind of tipped me to write Glide, is that I had not credited that first half of my swimming career from 8 to 14 at all. I thought that the things that I had achieved in my life had come about because I adhered to this motto that my coach used to write on the blackboard and the year before I started swimming for Australia. But my favourite was, when the going gets tough, the tough get going. And I thought, well, it was because I was tough that I'd managed to, you know, keep going, keep pushing through this trouble with my thinking, if you like, and still achieve things, you know, even though I had these other moments that were very difficult. But a story early on, I just started coaching and a mum approached me asking if I coach teenagers. And this is life coaching and not swimming coaching. And so at that time, you know, I was very new to it. And she told me a story that was quite challenging. Her teen, after a history of anxiety and depression, was now self-harming. So her teen was in a place that I wasn't comfortable going with. They were with the right medical people for their problem. But we did start talking about how this anxiety and depression might might have got hold. And it started with, you know, a story about a swimming competition or a running competition where the young person had got themselves to the final of the state championships, but had balked before the race and didn't run. And so the parent just thought, oh, well, you've got to have the right temperament. And then after that, all the problems began. I'm listening to this story thinking, my goodness, that was me. When I was 8 years old, I was always crying. And I landed at the DY Ladies when I was eight. I willingly turned up. My brother wanted a fiberglass surfboard, and Dad said he had to be able to swim 400 meters before he got his board. And so he went down 1 week and I followed in the next. But sort of true to form, I burst into tears in the blocks. Normally, tears had got me out of doing anything. But the DY Ladies immediately had an older girl jump in the water in front of me in my lane. And she gave me a big grin and said, come on, you can do this. And, you know, the gun went off and everyone was so kind that I sort of threw myself in, and I had a head out of water freestyle at the time. I, you know, I'd not learned to do big arms and breathing at that point. And she walked backwards down the lane, encouraging me on, saying, come on, you can do this. Apparently I was in tears. And then she got me to the end. And of course, once I got to the end, I was transformed, because that's exactly what I'd wanted to do. I just didn't know how to get there. And so I couldn't wait to come back down the next year. So I suddenly, with that story, remembered about four other occasions between the age of 8 and 14 when I'd been in tears and somebody had offered me that compassion, essentially, not judging you, not judging a little person for being scared, just saying, come on, it's normal that you're scared. We're going to get you through. And so over and over again, that happened. And so as soon as I started sort of putting all that in place, and then I realized that actually that going gets tough, the tough get going, coincided then with when I swam for Australia. It was just a really crummy time, unfortunately. We'd fallen behind the rest of the world. We weren't ready yet to make that shift from amateur to professional. And Australia had been sort of the last of the diehard amateurs. The rest of the world had become, you know, professional, or at least had institutes of sport and all that sort of stuff. We didn't, and we were still, you know, way behind. We wanted to think that we could run off Bondi Beach and dive into Olympic pool, and it just wasn't happening. So the first, you know, meeting I ever went to when I swam for Australia was a series of threats. You'll be sent home if you don't train hard enough, not disciplined, if the girls put on weight, like a bunch of things. And so suddenly you're like fearing what would happen if you didn't train hard enough. And that just, you know, gave rise to a voice of just driving myself to burnout.
So in the book, you refer a few times to the hero's journey, and this is a classic literary trope and plot device for moving the story forward. Can you elaborate on the hero's journey and how this relates to everyday life and the advice that you give in Glide?
Yeah, well, I first discovered it, you know, as a young writer, or I went to my first writing class, I think, in New York when I was living there, going to acting school, and started to think, oh, well, you know, there isn't a lot of acting work around. Everyone tells you when you start as an actor that 98% of actors are out of work, so I better write my own stuff. So this was 1990, and I thought, well, I suppose if I was a writer, I might write a story about a teenage person with talent who doesn't quite live up to her expectations, and can she call herself a success? That's how Making the Most of It came about. And so I was introduced to this hero's journey, something a man called Joseph Campbell identified by studying myths and legends over centuries, and that essentially to all stories there is a kind of a general pattern, if you like, that the hero, which we'll use non-gender specific, a girl or a man, but in those old stories, mostly men. But essentially, the hero hears the call to adventure. There is a spot where the hero often refuses the call to adventure. You know, a mentor steps in and offers them something that they need to cross the threshold and then go onto the road of trials. And, you know, it's not only a storytelling device, but also back in the 20s, you know, when it was Joseph Campbell was writing, there was also a lot of stuff around with Jung and, you know, the psychologists of the day. So the idea is that we shed the masks, we shed the stories or the behaviors or the habits that we've, you know, accumulated when we're young, and we cross over into the road of trials, and we, through a series of trials, we learn more about ourselves until we, you know, seize the elixir or whatever it happens to be, and we bring it back to our world that needs it. And so that when I heard the story about the young teenager who just got stuck in that place of self-harming after history of anxiety and depression, it was just classic refusing the call to adventure. And, you know, when I speak about it now, whenever I'm out talking to, you know, groups of people, whatever age, can sort of say, anyone ever procrastinated? Because the way that he describes it is, you know, that the flowering world becomes a barren wasteland of dry stones. You know, the positive is turned to a negative. Every house the hero builds will be a house of death. Well, if that isn't procrastination, I don't know what is. And so, you know, in terms of our mental health and in terms of those things that, you know, we all get stuck at different times. We all, you know, don't do that thing that we know that would be good for us or behave in the way that we would really like to. It's classic human behavior. We can forgive ourselves for that, offer ourselves some compassion and go, it's okay. And be essentially like the DY ladies and say, come on, sweetheart, you can do this, and kind of lead yourself through the fear to the other side. That's how I think the hero's journey and particularly that moment is sort of really helpful when it comes to day-to-day life. I use it all the time. Like if I'm, you know, nervous about whatever I'm doing, it's like, okay, well, we're just refusing the call to adventure. You and countless others over the centuries have done it. So come on, sweetheart, you can do this.
Glide came out earlier this year. It's an incredibly timely book, considering the major disruption that our society has gone through over the last few months with the COVID pandemic and lockdown. What are the main points you'd like your readers to take away from Glide, and what are your top Glide lines?
Yeah, it was an incredible time for it to be published. It was to be published last September, and my publisher said, look, let's hold it off. It'll get lost in the Christmas book, so let's wait till March.
And then it got lost in the pandemic.
Yeah, but we had the bushfires at first. I'm watching thinking, this is going to be interesting. And then COVID-19, yeah. And so it did get a bit lost. And that's okay. That's fine. That's essentially what Glide is about, that in fact, nothing is permanent. You know, we practice mindfulness. It's the wisdom of teachings of the Buddha 2,500 years ago. He was said, look, stress exists, but we cause ourselves more stress by not understanding that nothing is permanent and that we will all feel pain and that we can't control the world. So don't take it personally. So yes, it was an incredible to bring it out this time. And even as the book events were closing, you know, I did some advertising in other areas, like on social media. Some of the pushback was really interesting, like, how dare you, you're using this time to sell your book, you're taking advantage of. So it was actually distressing. That obviously was never the intention, and I've been writing it for a couple of years. So I guess even for somebody who practices it, I remember sitting in a cafe in the city. You know, I often take my laptop and write whatever I'm writing in a cafe for a couple of hours. I don't stay at home all the time to write. It's my shy way of being out in the world, if you like, sitting behind a laptop. So as it was shutting down, I noticed in myself this feeling in my body, that sadness and kind of loss, you know, for what was about to happen. And I thought, well, I was a bit cross with myself, even though I will say a Glide line is, you know, born of the Glide lines is self-compassion and that ability to empathize with whatever you're feeling rather than judging yourself. There was that moment that I thought, you meditate on this all the time. Impermanence is normal. Uncertainty is normal. So even you have been caught thinking that the way that you live your life is, you know, unchangeable. So, you know, haha, I've caught you out. But I, you know, then immediately was able to, you know, the Buddha never said, don't feel what you're feeling. He's not like the Stoics in that he sort of says, oh, just control your emotions. What the whole teachings of mindfulness is about is actually that we feel our emotions. We just let them pass through it, and we don't add to it with an extra story of, oh my goodness, what if it never goes back to the way that it was? What's going to happen? You know, we can get caught in that story and that anxiety of the future. So what I would like, I suppose, is in terms of, you know, the Glide lines, is to start with mindfulness. It's essentially awareness. So the awareness that, oh, I'm feeling sad about what is going on, and it's a feeling in the body. I often think of mindfulness as bodyfulness. So that would be a Glide line too, I suppose. The fact that mindfulness starts in the body, that feeling, uncertainty, impermanence, sadness, loss, it's a feeling in the body. Recognize it, allow it to be here, and just sort of take a deep breath and then let it go, or do whatever you need to do to take care of yourself at that moment. But to honor it, you know, to honor the fact that we are sensory beings. We live in this world and our senses are picking up, you know, all sorts of information. So the capacity for us to actually empathize with how we're feeling, but then to actually be able to, you know, use those gentle words of encouragement, like the DY ladies, come on, sweetheart, we can do this, we can manage it, is really important. So I think mindfulness in terms of awareness of what's going on in the body, and also that capacity to let go of the story and just come back to the breath. We don't need to start fearing or catastrophizing about what may be in the future. We just need to take care of this moment and then the next. I think also I've just finished teaching the 8-week course. MBSR is an 8-week course. And obviously this is not a real stressful moment in terms of, you know, if you're Mick Fanning with a great white shark next to you, Yes. You do need to actually activate the stress response. There's no doubt that fight, flight or freeze is necessary for that. But for most things, you know, we're not under physical threat all the time. So to understand that a demand is being made of us, but we also, along with that, need to have the belief or that we don't have the resources to meet the demand. So doubting ourselves in any moment of stress, it doesn't help. We, as humans, we underestimate ourselves and overestimate the demand quite often, because that's just the way we've evolved. So to understand that, we're feeling stressed because maybe we're doubting ourselves, and to actually, you know, again, come back to the body, come back to the breath, and just let that thought go, or even reassure ourselves with the number of times we have managed before in the past to cope, is a really good thing to do. And also, I love to swim, but the story of what I owed people or letting people down or fear of being sent home if I didn't prove myself got in the way of just that sheer gorgeousness of being in the water. And I think that when it comes to the world we're in, to actually be able to open up and go, wow, look at where we are in this country. So lucky in terms of space, in terms of the beauty of our nation, yeah, in terms of our weather, and to be able to open up to the joy that we feel in our country, but to actually open up to the good bits and allow ourselves to take in the joy of living here and the pleasure of being in this country is really helpful when it comes to mental health. And again, it's a skill because it's we don't want to when our resources are really focused, when we're really stressed, it's very hard to open up to that bigger picture. And it's just such a necessary skill.
So before we finish up today, I'd like to ask a reading or library-related question. You mentioned in Glide that you were incredibly shy as a child, and to overcome this, your mum created a reward system where little golden books were used as an incentive to coax you to school.
If I didn't cry for a week, if I didn't cry all week before going to school, I get a little golden book on a Friday, yes.
So is this where you developed your love of reading and books? And can you recommend for our library listeners some recent good books that you've read?
Yes, it is where I developed that. And also I think a love of reading, a beautiful way to escape. I was often, my mother often, you know, yelled, can you please get your head out of a book and do something, which meant, you know, clean up your bedroom, which was a bit of a mess. And also, I mean, I remember the first time I went to the Adelaide Festival and I had to talk about five books that influenced me, and I started with Swimming the Shane Gould Way, and the whole audience thought that was hilarious. But if you read Glide, you'll know the story of how influential Swimming the Shane Gould Way was. And so I've also relied on them for information. You know, the Thornbirds, for goodness sake, you know, back in the days before the internet, how did teenagers get information about sex unless you read of course Dolly, which was, you know, sort of okay, but then there's Wilbur Smith and old Colleen. So yes, I've always loved books, and even just that, oh, I'll never forget, you know, the moment that the plane started its descent, you know, when a plane begins its descent and you can hear the change in the engines, and we were descending and flying into Moscow, and, you know, you're going in behind the Iron Curtain into Robert Ludlum territory, and, you know, and the KGB and all this sort of stuff. And I thought, oh God, there's this big handsome Russian, he's going to ask me to help him defect, and we'll run down the boulevards and sort of dive into the Australian embassy and with the KGB hot on our heels. I love that idea of having a sort of another world on your shoulder, even as you're traveling around.
Yeah, being transported to another place by a book.
Totally. You know, My Brilliant Career was always, you know, one of the seminal books, of course, of your teenage years. I love Australian writers, of course. Sally Rooney, not an Australian writer, but her books have been, I've enjoyed both of them, and of Normal People. I love the Elena Ferrante novels. Oh, look, I kind of pick up anything, really.
No, that's great. I mean, it's nice to be reading across all sorts of genres.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, and I like my Lee A. Moriarty. I mean, I like, you know, anything. I try to read as much Australian stuff as I can. And
yeah, there's some fantastic Australian writing coming out at the moment.
Within that, of course, there's just always new stuff. I have a lot. I'm looking at my shelf at the moment and there's a lot of mindfulness and compassion books. So that's, you know, I try to balance out the nonfiction with the fiction, but I do tend to be reading a bit more of that. 10% Happier. There's, I think, even some of the stuff of Brené Brown's. Daring Greatly was one of my favourites of hers. Yeah, there's just so much good stuff. And just keeps coming out. And I think that the more that we can understand ourselves and bring compassion to our own experience, you know, it helps us understand that others also are, you know, finding it tough and finding a way to empathize and help
them.
Yeah,
certainly. And there's some great recommendations there that I'm sure a lot of our library listeners will be looking up. So thank you, Lisa, for your time. If you would like to hear more from Lisa, Glide has recently been published by Allen & Unwin and is available at all good local booksellers. Thank you for listening today, and look out for more upcoming digital content through the Inner West Library What's On and social media channels.